Sorry, I'm a little late. I had a meeting early this morning that took more than what I thought. Today we're going to talk about infectious disorders, particularly a new evolving problem. Before that, a few pieces of information. Today was the birth back in 1564 of Galileo Galilei. So enough said. Interestingly enough, on this day back in 1968 was the first telephone system in the U.S. to use 911, and it was done in Halleyville, Alabama. Isn't that interesting? But today is about infectious diseases, so we remember Richard Mead, who died on this day back in 1754. He was a British physician who contributed to preventive medicine and helped establish smallpox inoculation. He did a lot of work on measles and scurvy as well. And finally, we remember Andrew Moyer. Andrew Moyer died this week in 1959. He was an American microbiologist who invented a method for mass producing of the antibiotic penicillin. And because of this method, he was credited for saving thousands of lives during World War II. And with that, I leave you with our speaker of the day, Dr. Julio Ramirez, who, as you know, came to us many years ago as a trainee, evolved into become a stellar faculty, moved into becoming program director for fellowship as well as division director. He's well recognized for his work in pneumonia and other and HIV and other infectious disease problems. He developed a new journal that I just introduced to you last week called the UofL Journal of Respiratory Infections. Do I have that right? And with that, I'm going to leave you, Dr. Ramirez, who's going to tell you about Mycobacterium chimaera.
Thank you very much. And the idea of this ground round is to give you an overview of this new problem that we are facing, this global epidemic of Mycobacterium chimaera. And the outline of this presentation, I want to describe two clinical cases. We don't have any clinical case yet here, even though we are investigating several patients. Then these clinical cases are going to be from the literature. A little bit of the microbiology and infection control, the pathogenesis of this infection and the clinical presentation, what do we do at this moment for diagnosis and treatment, and then in the division, the members of the division, we got together several times and tried to put together what is going to be our management protocol as we get patients referred to us to evaluate for this possible infection. Then the clinical cases, and again, this is from the literature, this patient in 2008 has aortic and mitral reconstruction, implantation of a mitral annuloplastic ring. Then in 2 years later, the patient has fever, weight loss. At that moment, the primary consideration was prosthetic valve endocarditis, the patient with a prosthesis, but it has multiple blood cultures that were negative, a transesophageal echo that was just mild mitral and aortic insufficiency, but no vegetation. The workup for this patient with intermittent fever has multiple biopsies, and has an specific granulomatous inflammation, the liver, the kidney, some reticular pattern in the X-ray, a normal CO2 diffusion, and the bronchoalveolar valve was negative for mycobacteria. With this form of unclear, unspecific granulomatous disease, the patient was given a diagnosis of sarcoidosis, started on prednisone. And here you see that the patient didn't improve too much. The steroids were increased, the HIV test was negative, and the general condition, the patient deteriorated over the course of a year. Then it's 2011. Now it's getting worse, more respiratory distress. Blood cultures keep being repeated, blood cultures negative. Now the TE show evidence of severe regurgitation, and now the patient is transferred to have a valve replacement. Then on admission, the elevated C-reactive protein, they has abnormal in the mitral valve, the destruction of the aortic cups, and has replacement of the valves. And at this moment, we started on vancomycin, piperacillin, tazobactam, because, well, the patient has evidence of endocarditis. It may be some form of culture negative endocarditis. And finally, the histopathology, positive acid fast, consisted with mycobacterial endocarditis. And then mycobacterium neighbor complex was identified. That subsequently was specifically as mycobacterium chimera. Then he has disseminated non-tuberculous mycobacterial infection. The blood cultures became positive. The patient was started on clarithromycin, rifabutin, and ethambutol, and died 15 days later. And this would be one case that represents a classical presentation of prosthetic valve endocarditis with this organism. And now the second case is another patient that in this case has mechanical aortic valve and prosthetic aortic arch after aorta dissection in January 2010. That in 2011, again, is now hospitalized with fever and the splenomegaly, progressive renal insufficiency, elevated liver enzymes. The diagnosis is going to be prosthetic valve endocarditis, but again, negative, multiple blood cultures are negative, the TE without evidence of vegetation, but the patient has mycobacterial chimera positive culture for bone marrow, for the blood culture, from the urine, from the tracheal swab. They just disseminated mycobacterial chimera infection. HIV test negative, was started on clarithromycin, rifabutin, and ethambutol. But the patient, in April, almost 1 year later, died of a sudden splenic rupture due to a splenic infarction. It's interesting that he was on triple therapy. It's almost 1 year on triple therapy. Blood culture became negative. But you can see here the post-mortem, there's acid-fast positive bacteria in the spleen, the liver, the kidney. Then he still have almost 1 year on therapy, still mycobacterium chimera in multiple granulomas in different organs. Then moving into the microbiology and infection control issues with this organism. Then we know that when we look at the mycobacteria, we always have the mycobacterium tuberculosis, or the mycobacterium tuberculosis complex with mycobacterium lepra. And then what we call, used to be called the non-tuberculous mycobacterium or mycobacterial adenoid tuberculosis or MOT or atypical mycobacteriums, all these names to say, okay, this is not tuberculosis, these are the other guys. Now it's called NTM, non-tuberculous mycobacterium. From this non-tuberculous mycobacterium, if we look at what happened with our patients, we know that the most common one is MAC, Mycobacterium avium complex. There are multiple. There are more than, 200, but the most common will be MAC. And MAC is composed, the Mycobacterium chimera is part of the MAC complex. Then we have Mycobacterium avium, Mycobacterium intracellulari, not Mycobacterium chimera. These will be the three that are in the MAC. Now, when we remember this non-tuberculous mycobacterium, we know that they are present in the soil, the water. They are essentially in the environment, all over the environment. And they enter humans either by inhalation or ingestion. Tap water is the number one source for non-tuberculous mycobacterium. People said, tell me what is in your water, and I tell you what non-tuberculous mycobacterium you're going to be infected with. And we know that in this case, there is no person-to-person transmission. And in clinical practice, what we've seen is either pulmonary disease or disseminated disease with non-tuberculous mycobacterium. The pulmonary disease is, for us, will be the classical patient that we see at the VA hospital, COPD, chronic lung disease, that has an upper lobe cavity, looks like tuberculosis, pulmonary that the bronchoscopy, and the appears MAC, and multiple culture, repeat cultures of MAC, and then we treat the patient with MAC pulmonary disease. There is also the MAC pulmonary disease in the female without chronic lung disease. That is a different syndrome. And for disseminated disease, this came along when the HIV/AIDS epidemic, and remember that initially, before the highly active antiretroviral therapy, any HIV patient with a very low CD4 count is going to have, that was admitted with fever of unknown origin and loss of weight and feeling poorly, and the positive blood culture were positive for MAC. And we have a stool, has a stool positive for MAC, and sometimes MAC in the sputum. And these are the classical patients that you do the bone marrow biopsy, and you have the full macrophages exploding from the AFB, and this was MAC. Then we were well aware of disseminated disease with MAC, primarily in the immunocompromised patient, HIV patient with a CD4 usually below 50. Then this is what we were having before this Mycobacterium chimera. Now, all these non-tuberculous Mycobacterium, these are primarily community-acquired infections, as we see. Now, over the years, we've seen on and off hospital-acquired infections or nosocomial-acquired infections for non-tuberculous Mycobacterium. As a matter of fact, I was remembered with Ruth Carrico that years ago we have an outbreak here or central line bloodstream infection. We have 3 or 4 cases for a non-tuberculous Mycobacterium. And whenever you have a problem in the hospital with a nosocomial outbreak, essentially you go and figure out how is that water came in contact with the patient, because these non-tuberculous Mycobacteria are always in the water. Then healthcare-associated non-tuberculous Mycobacterium infection primarily has been described in the literature as central line infection. And now we have this Mycobacterium chimera, healthcare-associated infection, after cardiopulmonary surgery, that this is what we are discussing today. Then the case number one was a Mycobacterium chimera prosthetic valve endocarditis. And case number two was disseminated disease. Case number two, at the time of pathology, they look at the aorta and they look at the graft, there was no infection. It was a disseminated disease without Mycobacterium chimera in the prosthesis. And you see that we are seeing two different types of syndrome. The prosthetic valve endocarditis and disseminated disease that we used to see with MAC in our HIV patients. Now these were two cases reported in 2013, that happened again in 2011, from the same hospital. And these two cases doing PCR, a DNA PCR, were essentially the same Mycobacterium. Then this is similar to what happened when we have the Mycobacterium here with a couple of central line infections. The first thing that you do is you feel, is this the same Mycobacterium? If this is the same Mycobacterium, well, you know where to look. The question is in the water in the hospital. Then these two cases, two patients die in this particular hospital in Europe, started the outbreak investigation. Again, a special emphasis in the nosocomial source waterborne pathogen. And this was also published. This group, they look at contaminated cardioplegic or valve preserving solutions, and they couldn't find it there. Of course, the water supply system in the operating room, you always culture the water to figure out, and chimera was not there. It may be contamination of a sternotomy wound. It may be colonization of the prosthetic material due to the patient has a line infection, again, a central line infection that is common, and this may be the cause, but there was no evidence. Implanted bioprosthetic valves. Sometimes the valves are prepared, and you may have Mycobacterium chimera coming from the source of the valve, but it was not evidence. And then, of course, there's always the possibility of false positive results, because another thing that we always consider when you have one or two cases, one case, let's say, of meningitis due to non-tuberculous Mycobacterium, another patient, then you immediately go to microbiology to see if they are culturing any sputum of a patient with non-tuberculous mycobacteria, because cross-contamination in microbiology is very common, because these get into the air and then you contaminate other cultures. There is always the consideration, is this a false outbreak that may be going on? Well, the point is that they published all this and they couldn't detect what was the source of this. They have two patients with Mycobacterium chimera, the both patients died, and after an extensive outbreak investigation, the result was negative. Then how do we understand this today with multiple cases and now with the CDC involved, the European CDC involved, now everybody's involved in looking at this outbreak. And we know that the patient is going to have some form of cardiovascular surgery. We are going to have the heart and lung machine. In one place, you have the cardioplegic fluid to maintain the heart at a low temperature. On the other hand, you need to have the blood circulating, that this has to be maintained at a warm temperature. And every time that we have cardiothoracic surgery, it's going to be a heater cooler unit, and these units have water tanks. One water tank has cold water, and the water goes and maintains this area cold, and another water tank with warm water to maintain the warmth of the patient's blood. These units also to maintain the temperature, they have a blower that takes air from the operating room and move air out, and this is all, of course, this will be all the operating room. Then in this, as part of these outbreaks, as we always discuss, whenever you have non-tuberculous mycobacteria, you go and you culture every place where there is water because you are looking, because these are water organisms. Then the Mycobacterium chimera in plenty of these cardiothoracic, in plenty of these units, was isolated from the cold water as well as the warm water from the water tanks of these heated cooler units. Still, the possibility of this water getting in contact with the blood of the patient is almost 0%. Nothing is 0% in medicine, but it's almost 0%. Then, still, the connection of how the chimera went into the patient was unclear. But then, some of the chimera from these water tanks were getting into the heater killer unit outside of the water tank through some permeation. And now you have the chimera here, and now this air coming in, and now you have air coming out, and now you have chimera all over the operating room. Then, essentially, you have a mycobacterium that's being blowing out from the heated cooler unit into the full operating room. Then now we understand that this is an airborne contamination of the surgical site and at the same time of anything that is in the operating room, also the prosthetic material. And the idea is that the chest is open, Mycobacterium chimera can deposit in the chest, but also the prosthetic valve is waiting there, and we have Mycobacterium chimera floating into the valve, and then we implanted the valve that is already contaminated with the microorganism. Now, another thing that is interesting of this outbreak is that then we have a patient dying of Mycobacterium chimera in United States, and a patient die of Mycobacterium chimera in Australia. And you do DNA PCR, they are almost the same bacteria. Now, we know, as we mentioned this, whenever this water, there is non-tuberculous mycobacteria, but still there are some geographic differences. So it's going to be unlikely that your patient with bronchiectasis and a non-tuberculous mycobacteria is going to have the same one that a patient with bronchiectasis in other parts of the world, because in different areas you have different strains. And the explanation here of this particular situation, then here you have, because then when you have the same mycobacterium, you're looking for the common source outbreak. Now, having the same mycobacterium in my three patients in a unit at the university hospital, it makes sense. But having the same mycobacterium in different countries, it couldn't make sense. Then the answer to this is the area where the units are produced, this town in Germany, this is where the contamination were occurring. During the development of the machine, and then this heater cooler device, the 3T, this company in Germany has more than 70% of the worldwide distribution of these heater cooler devices. Then it doesn't matter where you have your cardiovascular surgery. If it's going to be in the U.S., Australia, or South Africa, chances are that in the operating room, there was one of these devices maintaining the proper temperature of the blood of the patient and the cardioplegic solution. And then with the CDC now involved, seems to be that in the water supply where the machines were produced, this is where the M. chimera was originated, that was moved all over the world, and really more than all over the world, to all over different operating rooms. To complicate things further, there is no clear evidence that once these machines are contaminated, can be effectively decontaminated. Because the solution is, well, I know that it's a machine, let me clean the machine. But it seems to be that the development of the machine is such as that once the mycobacterium chimera, it has developed biofilms in the machines, sometimes cultures can become negative, but then can appear positive again. Then this is not, is one of these outbreaks with not an easy fix from the source. And of course, goes without saying that some these are not type of surgeries that you can delay until you resolve the problem. But I'm concentrated today primarily in the clinical aspects of this outbreak. Then moving into the pathogenesis and clinical presentation. Then pathogenesis of Mycobacterium chimera. I have to tell you that the pathogenesis is unknown because this is a new disease. But for us, even though the pathogenesis is unknown, we need to have something to work. We know that the best pathogenesis is for Mycobacterium tuberculosis. And I'm going to mention Mycobacterium tuberculosis, and I'm going to completely speculate and assume that this is just us in infectious diseases. Imagine what would be the possible pathogenesis of Mycobacterium chimera. Then we know that in the case of Mycobacterium tuberculosis, we breathe the Mycobacterium inside of the lung, and there is a primary infection. And we know that most of the time, if the person is immunocompromised, the person may have primary tuberculosis disease that may be in the lung as primary pneumonia, or the patient may have disseminated tuberculosis, miliary tuberculosis, or even tuberculosis in different organs, not TB meningitis, primary disease. But we know that this happened probably less than 5% of the individuals. 95% are going to go to latent tuberculosis infection, LTBI. Then we know that this formation of granuloma here, the granuloma is going to contain the disease, and you go to latent tuberculosis infection. And then 5, 10, 20 years down the road, the person may develop the reactivation of tuberculosis. Again, reactivation of tuberculosis, wherever this is a granuloma, maybe classically in the lung, but maybe in any other part, spot disease or any other form of reactivation of tuberculosis. Seems to be, for the clinical cases described in the literature, that we can mimic this pathogenesis for Mycobacterium chimera. In this case, the entry, as we mentioned, is at the time of surgery. And in the literature, there has been some cases that 1, 2, 3 months after surgery, the person develops signs and symptoms of disease. I can imagine this as primary Mycobacterium chimera disease. But then the classical scenario is 2, 3, 4, 5 years after surgery, during this period of incubation. And we know that in the pathology there are granulomas. Then most likely, at the point of entry in surgery, plenty of patients develop granulomas. The granulomas contain the mycobacterium, and then years down the road, you get reactivation of disease. It's very similar to what happened with mycobacterium tuberculosis. Now, it is also, in the literature, some people say, well, how many years? The longest case after surgery has been 5 years reported of disease. Then people say, well, we have 5 years as a way to go back and figure out you have surgery, because you have surgery 7 years ago. Well, we consider that this is a little bit of nonsense, because 5 years is one patient. But looking at what happened with mycobacterial disease, who can say that this mycobacterium cannot reactivate 6 years, 7 years, 20 years? We're still learning. But I will not say, we will not say that, oh no, your surgery was 7 years ago, you are not, you don't have a problem. Because you may have probable reactivation of disease, now 5 years the longest, but it may go longer than this. And this will be the pathogenesis. How do we see that this happened? Then the entry is at the point of surgery. Then the most common initial complaint has been fever, night sweat, shortness of breath, fatigue, weight loss. This is, and it's a mycobacterium type of presentation. But it's also interesting, the clinical syndrome, how the patient is going to present. As I mentioned, the incubation period is months or years after surgery. To me, it's primary disease or reactivation of disease. And what are the clinical syndromes? There is the clinical syndrome of local infection. Sternotomy wound infection, external bone osteomyelitis, retrosternal abscess, mediastinitis, saphenal vein site infection. Remember that when the patient is in the operating room, the chest is open, the leg is open, and you have mycobacterium chimaera in the air. And this, to me, is a clear manifestation of primary disease. The bacteria are right there, and you get primary disease. This will be local infection. Then, of course, this changed a lot of things that we're doing in infectious disease, because now all of a sudden, now after cardiothoracic surgery, a culture negative osteomyelitis, we need to put these things in the differential diagnosis. Then there is the intravascular infection. We put the prosthesis, and in the prosthesis, we essentially deposit the mycobacterium chimaera, and the person develops the prosthetic valve endocarditis or the prosthesis. This will be a classical infection with granulomas and also with biofilm, because this is always a chronic infection. Then there is the consideration for disseminative infection, as I mentioned, without endocarditis. Then this patient may have hepatitis, splenomegaly, pancytopenia, osteomyelitis, the eye that is heavily involved. This would be almost the MAC disseminated infection that we learn for HIV patients. This would be, but again, subacute chronic disseminated infection. And the last syndrome described in the literature is this syndrome of granulomatous disease. The patient is feeling poorly, he's not doing well, fevers on and off, and then you start getting biopsies, and you see all these non-specific granulomas that are going to be AFB negative because they are minimal number of mycobacterium. And these are the several cases in the literature with diagnosis of sarcoidosis and given steroids. But we know that all sarcoidosis is an infectious disease. In this case, it was just, this is for sure. This is a mycobacterium chimaera. Okay, then this will be the fourth syndrome that may be months or maybe years after surgery. This will be, but again, this prosthetic, this intravascular infection, disseminated infection, remember, for instance, case number one, it was almost 1 year, the patient on steroids, and they finally got positive blood cultures. Then how do we have for diagnosis and treatment? Then PPD and QuantiFERON are going to be negative. Even though we know that whenever we give a PPD to a patient, it's very common to have some form of induration. Now we have different consideration of induration to call it positive. But we know that whenever we get 1, 2, 3 millimeters induration, this is induration due to non-tuberculous mycobacterium that will be in contact. But essentially, the induration of the mycobacterium chimera is not going to give us a positive PPD or quantiferol. The regular aerobic and anaerobic blood cultures are going to be negative, and the blood cultures are going to be positive. Of course, we need to request a specific blood culture for AFB, and they need to have 10 to 100 organisms per ml. Based on the literature, seems to be we have a lot of patients that were symptomatic. We have a fever, we have a night sweat, have multiple blood cultures negative for AFB blood cultures, indicating that probably the bacteremia initially, the patient may be symptomatic without bacteremia. It's going to continue, it's going to have intermittent bacteremia, and finally, at the end of the spectrum, you're going to have a persistent bacteremia. And the point is that a negative blood culture for AFB doesn't rule out the disease in this case. Now, then we go to tissue cultures, because usually we just go for a bone marrow biopsy, trying to identify organisms, and then tissue PCR. Now, the laboratory, all our laboratories are going to identify MAC, Mycobacterium avium complex. You need to have a special laboratory to figure out in the complex if this is Mycobacterium chimera. It was interesting to me when I read that Mycobacterium chimera is very similar to Mycobacterium intracellular. There is only a single nucleotide difference in the 16 ribosomal DNA. Then these are very, very similar organisms, but every laboratory is going to say the patient has positive blood culture for MAC, Mycobacterium avium complex. Then we need to send that we suspect we go to State Department and provide the identification. Antimicrobial therapy, and we learned this with HIV, with our HIV patients. Before, when we used to do NIH, the relapse and the clinical cure was very poor. Now we know that the primary drugs are macrolides, either clarithromycin or azithromycin, rifamycin, rifampin, rifabutin or rifapentin, tambutol. These three are always a part of every regimen for MAC. Then there are the possibility of aminoglycosides, amikacin, streptomycin or quinolones, levo or moxie. Surgical intervention, probably because of the biofilm, is going to be critical, and these patients require long-term combination antimicrobial therapy. Of course, nobody knows how much is long-term. The experts suggest that at least 1.5 to 2 years of treatment. And then finally, what is our management protocol? How do we how are we going to evaluate these patients? Well, I think that the first consideration, if a patient calls you or a patient comes to your office, because this is, again, this is going to be the internist approach. Then the person arrives and said, is any possibility for me to be exposed to this microorganism? Well, it's going to be the type of surgery and the date of surgery. There are more than 250,000 bypass surgeries in the United States every year. We need to go several years down the road. Then chances are that some of your patients are going to contact you regarding this possibility. We also understand that in plenty of institutions, letters have been sent to everybody that have bypass surgery describing the possibility that they may have been exposed to this type of microorganism. And we also know that all our veterans that were having bypass surgery were sent a letter. There's a hotline that they can call, but also they say contact your primary physician if you have further questions. Now, another thing that is interesting is that prosthetic material is number one, but it's not a prerequisite for infection since some patients with bypass surgery has been documented infection. For that you know, if the patient has a prosthetic valve, this is high risk, or any form of prosthetic material. But even without prosthesis, this may occur. As we mentioned, as long as the chest is open and you have this machine in the operating room, the possibility of airborne deposit of the microorganism exists. For instance, there are cases of Mycobacterium chimaera pleural infection in patients with lung transplant. Then you don't need to have a cardiac bypass. As long as the chest is open and you have the device. And there's also the consideration that these heated cooler devices, we discussed one and two for the open heart surgery, but they also use for warming cooling blankets. Then any form of extensive surgery, where you need a blanket, is a good possibility that this machine was used. Then extensive neurosurgical procedures, extensive orthopedic procedures, where you have a blanket. Now you say, well, the blanket is on the patient, the water circulates. Yeah, but the water is not the problem. The problem is the air, the machine that maintains the water warm, that is putting the Mycobacterium in the air in the operating room. Has not been cases described here yet, but the chances are, at least for us, the patient has a blanket and they were put on a new hip, and now you have a hip infection with culture negative, we are going to be thinking the possibility of Mycobacterium chimaera in this type of surgeries. Then, was the patient exposed, yes or no? If the patient was exposed, that the patient has latent Mycobacterium chimaera infection, as we have LTBI, well, you come to our clinic, LTBI, yes, I do a PPD, QuantiFERON, I know you have latent infection or not. Here, there's no way to know. We don't have any tests. You see, I have surgery 3 years ago. Am I infected? Do I have a latent infection? Do I have a granuloma inside of me with a Mycobacterium chimaera someplace living on me? There's no way to know. You've been exposed. We assume that you've been exposed. Well, there's a possibility. And we're going to continue this line. Now, of course, the next question is, from a latent infection, do I have active disease? We apply the same concept that tuberculosis. You have latent tuberculosis infection, you are asymptomatic, no signs and symptoms. When you develop signs and symptoms, and you have a positive QuantiFERON, the question is this tuberculosis or not? It should be the same. Is this the patient has Mycobacterium disease or not? Then we look at the clinical history, physical exam, routine laboratory. We are still considering all this happening in the with the primary care physician or the cardiologist or the non-ID doctor that is discussing the patient. If the patient is completely asymptomatic, then the patient doesn't have a possibility of active disease, we have to have a regular follow-up. If the patient is symptomatic, then we consider that probably ID referral would be appropriate. And for this, at our VA hospital, we open a clinic on Tuesday afternoon to evaluate these patients. And here in our 550 clinic, here in the ambulatory care building, we open a clinic Thursday afternoon. And these will be two clinics that we have to, if any one of you have a patient that has been exposed due to the type of surgery, that the patient is symptomatic, and you want us to have further evaluation, then we have this clinic that we have here, the 550 clinic Thursday afternoon, is the same clinic that we have. We have a clinic for latent tuberculosis infection, for LTBI, that essentially this clinic emerged primarily for all the needs that we have now patients with LTBI and with all these TNF inhibitors or all these immunomodulators that we're using in patients with rheumatoid arthritis, with psoriasis, the question is going to be also, if we're going to use these immunomodulators in this type of patient, what may happen with the possibility of reactivation of Mycobacterium chimaera? But these will be Tuesdays or Thursdays for the two areas. Now, once we see the patient, we are going to, again, look at the clinical history, physical exam, routine laboratory, and we are going to say, well, the possibility of Mycobacterium chimaera disease may be very low or may be very high. We have an algorithm that we follow in the clinic. And we may have a patient that we're just going to do follow-up and nothing else, or we are going to do imaging studies that primarily is going to be the echocardiogram, blood cultures, special blood cultures, tissue cultures. But essentially, this is an infectious disease consultation in a patient that usually is going to have fever after cardiac surgery, but fever or night sweats. For that, you need to rule out tuberculosis. You need to rule out all other forms of infection, because this is going to be unspecific. These signs and symptoms are going to be very unspecific. If we have a patient that we have diagnosed of Mycobacterium chimaera disease, if this patient is going to have then combination therapy. This combination therapy at this moment, people are suggesting probably at least 3, but probably 4 or 5 drugs the patient tolerate. Surgical intervention is going to be essential. And finally, the million-dollar question still is this infection is going to be able to be cured or not? Because at this moment, people say, well, there's 50% mortality. But the other 50% that didn't die, you still have to treat the patient for 1.5, 2 years. And then after treatment, you still have to follow the patient for 1 or 2 years to see if it's going to be a relapse. Then we still don't know. But they say, remember case number 2. The patient has disseminated disease, was treated with 3 drugs, and 1 year later died, and has Mycobacterium chimera in the granulomas in every organ after 1 year of therapy. This reminds me what happened with the initial therapy of MAC in HIV patients. The patient was doing very poorly, positive blood culture, we start triple therapy, and the blood culture became negative. But you repeat the bone marrow, the MAC was still there in the granuloma. And the question is, are these patients going to be able to cure of this disease or not? We are still in the process of treating these patients. And essentially, this has been a brief overview of whatever we understand today, and a little bit of whatever we consider. The clinical cases reported now in multiple countries. The microbiology, this during all this process, a lot of these machines have been cultured. A lot of water has been cultured, and of course, there's a lot of these machines that have been contaminated with other non-tuberculous mycobacteria, with other organisms that like water, for example, Legionella pneumophila. And there has been a lot of interest on the problem of having machines moving air in the operating room that may be contaminated, and we didn't even recognize that this was going on. The infection control issues are still there. The pathogenesis that we don't know, but we assume that probably we have primary disease, a latent period of infection, and then reactivation of disease. It's interesting also that some of this reactivation happened in patients with diagnosis of sarcoidosis that were given steroids at the moment that the patient is immunocompromised for the medication, get the reactivation of the disease. Another thing that, as I mentioned, the clinical case, this is not reactivation that all of a sudden the person is very sick. For example, this patient was 1 year on steroids for treatment of sarcoidosis until finally became very sick and developed a positive blood culture. The clinical presentation is a case of chronic tuberculosis with night sweats, fever, feeling poorly, but the clinical presentation is multiple. Probably also another thing that is confusing, that this is, in the case of tuberculosis, we used to say this, you have latent tuberculosis infection, LTBI, or you have active tuberculosis infection. Either the mycobacterium is dormant, or the mycobacterium wake up, multiply, and now you have disease. And everything was black or white. Life was simple. Either you have dormant infection, active infection. But now, even in tuberculosis, it seems to be that the latent tuberculosis infection goes for periods of reactivation, and then it's getting worse until finally you get tuberculosis, the full disease. The way that I was reading the literature here is that this may be something similar, because the patient has been sick for months, almost 1 year, before getting positive blood cultures. So once you get granulomas with mycobacterium, there is some activity, then the immune response activated, the activity decreased, more activity decreased. This is why the patient may be sick slowly, feeling poorly for months and months without having, even though he has endocarditis, but it's not a fulminant case. The diagnosis, we already discussed, we need to get a special blood cultures and probably tissue. The treatment, that is 3 to 5 drugs, and then I mentioned the management protocol that we are suggesting here in our local area. And with this, thank you very much for your attention. No, we don't have a
in the United States, how many of the CDC?
In the United States, around 15 cases.
Okay.
All this is, again, this is an emergent. Everybody said that, yeah, this is the tip of the iceberg.
So much of what you discuss is to prepare us and make us alert about this possibility. You didn't mention a lot about preventive care. So two questions about this is the problem gone? Are the machines taking care of it? Are we culturing every machine we have here? What is the process for preventive care?
Yeah, the CDC, working with the European CDC, the area where the machine is produced after 2014, 2015, the machines, in theory, are now, they said there's no more contamination of the new machines. Then in theory, the new. Now, there are reports that even with the new machines, you can still find some mycobacterium. Then the issue is not completely resolved. The new machines, and then you have all the considerations that the FDA and the CDC suggest here. In some hospitals, the primary consideration has been putting the heating cooler device outside of the operating room, making extensive tubing, and then the air is in the corridor. You need to be sure that the operating room has a tight door. But sometimes you have operating rooms that are one attached to another. You don't have the possibility to have a machine. But then people are looking at considerations. Yeah, because at the end of the day, it seems to be that the even though the problem in Germany has been resolved, this machine with water seems to be that then there are new rules on how to clean these machines properly. This is something that before this outbreak seems to be that was not in the consideration that here you have a machine moving air with water, and now you know, the water is supposed to be sterile that you put in the machine, how often you have to change the water, do you have to culture the machines. Again, none of these solutions is as simple because culture the machine can give you negative cultures today, positive cultures tomorrow. Since the bacteria is probably in biofilm inside, yes. Not for this particular infection. We know, usually what I do is I translate for non-tuberculous mycobacterium or mycobacterium itself to this infection. And this infection is contained by development of granuloma. And then to me, the way that I look at this is you have primary disease is probably because you are immunocompromised at the moment that you have your surgery. Of course, you may say, well, one of the primary risk factors for tuberculosis is reactivation is diabetes. Well, how many patients that are going to have this type of surgery have already diabetes? Then I don't think that nobody's going to have this type of surgery. It's going to be not some form of immunocompromised condition. But there's no question that the capability to form granuloma and maintain this, I'm sure it's going to be, we know that in tuberculosis, once you get a mycobacterium tuberculosis from person to person, we know that 90% of the people that acquire mycobacterium tuberculosis, you develop a granuloma, you die, and you're never aware. Then the 90% of the population is able to control mycobacterium tuberculosis. I imagine that, again, a lot of these people that acquire the mycobacterium in the air are going to develop granulomas, I have to assume that the majority are just going to die with the granuloma. And the question is going to be, are you develop some form of immunocompromised condition that is going to predispose to the reactivation? To me, the message, as you mentioned, is any form of surgery, I mean, the operating room, they are in the operating room, has not been, I mean, everybody's surprised that we have a machine put in air, and the machine may have anything that is in the water may be there, and we just, and then you say, why we didn't think about this before? No, but the idea is that any form of subacute chronic presentation in any patient with a major surgery, just to put this in the differential diagnosis as a consideration. The patient has a culture negative endocarditis, for us, oh yeah, the patient may be Legionella, maybe Bartonella. We have the list of culture negative endocarditis and we throw something. This now is high in the list of culture negative endocarditis. The patient has surgery. This is the approach. It's a new infectious disease that we need to have in the list for differential diagnosis. Yeah, these units has air filters. Yes, they are part of the unit. And all these, the primary solution has been the unit outside of the operating room. And probably knowing that there is water, and knowing that on and off the water needs to be replaced, and knowing what we know on the water in the hospital that there is maybe Legionella, maybe Mycobacterium, maybe Pseudomonas. Probably this idea of having something that blow air is not a good idea. Then I'm sure that in the future, these things are going to disappear from the operating room. And then as we discussed with Ruth so many things, these are machines that are developed for one purpose, but nobody's considering the possibility of how do I clean the machine. It was not done in a way that is easily to clean. Then once they are contaminated, it's impossible to, and mostly because of the biofilm.
Can you comment on what your recommendation
for the prosthetic valve graft and the prosthetic who you consider reoperating versus prosthetic surgery? Given the fact that reoperating time is of the infection, the approach here will be that without surgery, cure is zero. As I mentioned, with surgery, cure is going to be 10%, 20%, we don't know. It may be even with surgery, but without surgery, we know that the cure is going to be no possible. Because of the biofilm, and we know the granulomas and biofilm in the prosthesis. Is the prosthesis is infected? Because this is another thing. We have patients with positive blood cultures. They have the prosthesis, but they have disseminated disease without the prosthesis being infected. Then if the suggestion that the prosthesis is infected without surgery is going to be very difficult to treat. Then we're discussing, this is similar to what happened with patients with osteomyelitis. Again, going back to a different consideration. Patient has a prosthetic knee, and you have osteomyelitis, you have infected prosthetic knee. And sometimes the orthopedics say, well, I already have three knees in this patient. I cannot put a new knee. There's no more bone in the femur. If I need to remove these knees above the knee amputation, then what do you know? The infection is going to be there. We come out with a cocktail that we are going to treat you with antibiotics for the rest of your life. Well, this is the way that I almost see your case. Oh, this patient cannot have surgery because sometimes you have the aortic valve and a piece of the aorta and you cannot replace this. Well, this is going to be therapy for the rest of your life. It's going to be full therapy, suppressive therapy. This is something that will need to be discussed. Then the goal will not be a cure of the disease. The goal will be maintain negative blood cultures and some form of life expectancy. And we have patients with antibiotic therapy for suppressive therapy of joint infections that then die of cancer 5 years later. And at least they were walking with it, and they didn't have the above-the-knee amputation.
Thank you.
Well,
if I had surgery last year or 2 years ago and I'm positive for this by DNA.
Well, we don't have any any way at this moment to do this now, because the question would be, you have a liver biopsy, you have a granuloma, but you are asymptomatic. You have a liver biopsy for something else. And you have a granuloma, and you have a PCR positive for a mycobacterium. And then you will give me a clinical scenario of a patient with a mycobacterium chimera infection, a latent infection, but you don't have disease. Then I was thinking, well, if you have latent tuberculosis infection, I treat you to prevent disease. You give me a patient with mycobacterium chimera infection, should we treat you to prevent disease? This is all new. this would be a latent tuberculosis, a latent mycobacterium chimera infection that you make a diagnosis. Should this patient get azithromycin and ethambutol for 6 months in an attempt to prevent disease in the future? I will probably do it. Because this is why we treat LTBI. You prevent development of active disease in the future.
Well, thank you, everyone. Stay away from the OR.
Thank you. Okay,
sorry, I was late.
No, please.